بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. I really wanted to be here as a listener, and that's what I plan on doing, inshallah, along with everyone else, is trying to listen, inshallah, as much as possible to our leaders, to those who rightfully feel the pain of this destructive system of white supremacy and have felt it for a long time, and those who can guide us, inshallah ta'ala, as to what the proper response should be. I want to start off by saying that my intention for everything that I'm about to share is to help process some of these thoughts myself, inshallah ta'ala. And so I want to invite all of the esteemed imams and leaders that are on this call to challenge anything that I say that might be wrong, to rebuke me if you see fit. And I want to say that anything that I'm going to say right now is open to critique and is not a critique of anyone else right now that is trying to have a helpful and meaningful intervention for justice in this. This is not the time to throw shade at one another. This is the time to grow one another so that we can all be shaded under the throne of Allah on the day of judgment. And I start off with the hadith of the ship. The Prophet ﷺ gave us this beautiful example of a people on a ship, some on the upper deck and some on the lower deck. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, giving this example of the people on the upper deck not providing water to the people on the lower deck. And so the people on the lower deck drill holes into the ship and they sink the ship. And as a result, and I thought about, I don't want to use the word vandalize and then someone says that I'm using a hadith to justify looting. I'm saying it's a powerful example and a powerful message in that. SubhanAllah, that the Prophet ﷺ said that if the people do not take the water to those on the lower deck, then the entire ship will sink. And the Prophet ﷺ putting the burden, and of course this was a method, an analogy of hidayah, of guidance, putting the burden on the people on the upper deck. And the African proverb, if the youth are not initiated into the village, they will burn it down just to feel its warmth. I want us to think about what awakened our conscience, and I'm speaking to everyone with everything that's taking place right now. At what point did we feel a necessity to weigh in with injunctions and interjections from the Quran and the Sunnah to eradicate evil? At what point did we feel sleeplessness? At what point did we feel like the situation around us demands a response? And if the answer to that question is that it was not until what has transpired in the last week or so that we felt compelled to speak out on this evil and this issue and to move forward, then we have to really ask ourselves why we were so undisturbed for so long while this issue has been present. And was it because we felt distant from the issue and hence comfortable knowing that this issue was not, quote unquote, my issue for whatever reason? And how is that from the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ? And I want us to think about our Messenger ﷺ as we talk about issues and methods from the Quran and the Sunnah, to talk about his deep empathy ﷺ, and the sense of anger that he felt when he saw injustice and dhulm, not even just towards a human being, but even towards animals. When the Prophet ﷺ was marching with his companions forward, and in the midst of quote-unquote bigger issues, the Prophet ﷺ sees a bird that complains to him that her child has been stolen from the nest, and the Prophet ﷺ, with a deep sense of anger and pain, says, "Man faza'a hadhihi biwaladiha?" Who has caused this mother this stress with her child? Can you imagine then the Prophet ﷺ staring at not one or two, but the thousands of mothers of victims of police brutality and not feeling a great sense of pain on the inside of him sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And if we would say, well, it's out of sight and I didn't see it, and what made the Greg Floyd video so disturbing is that it was videotaped, is that it's there, is that you can watch over an extended period of time the slow, cruel, heartless execution of a man who has not been given value in this country because of the color of his skin, with no fear of accountability in the eyes of that officer that has operated in a system that grants immunity to murderous police officers for so long. What if the Prophet ﷺ watched that video? What if the Prophet ﷺ looked at the mothers of those victims of police brutality and saw the pain and the screaming and the tears and the hopelessness and the despair? And if we are to consider ourselves heirs of the Prophet ﷺ, then we have to take on that burden of concern as well. When Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu was the Khalifa, and he was a man that is distinguished by his sense of justice, and he was disturbed by any creation of Allah complaining against him on the Day of Judgment that did not directly involve him, but that operated anywhere under his control, even out of sight, then we have to ask ourselves, why was I not disturbed? When I watched that video, did I feel nothing on the inside of myself and only think, let me go ahead and give a, you know, weigh in with my opinions online right away? Or did I sit with that pain for a little bit? I gave the story of a woman in my community, because actually someone from Mothers Against Police Brutality reminded me in the wake of the murder of Botham John and his mother in Dallas becoming a face of Mothers Against Police Brutality, that we should try to uplift the names of those who were never given hashtags. And I mentioned Dr. Jamila Arshad, who in my community in New Orleans was murdered viciously, a doctor that was driving on her way home and saw a young boy that was riding his bike and hit by a car. And she stopped over to support, to resuscitate that boy. And instead, she ended up, by the way, with an officer twice her size sitting on top of her. And subhanAllah, after I shared that video, her husband actually showed me yesterday the autopsy and said it's the same autopsy as Greg Floyd, that she actually died of the suffocation. The cardiac arrest was brought on by the officer sitting on top of her and putting that weight on her and murdering her callously without any fear of repercussions. And by the way, that officer still on the force. Why? Because it wasn't on video? Is it when we feel distant with things, we are okay with the status quo? And that's the problem, is that we cannot be okay with the status quo because we feel like we are not touched by the status quo. And it's only when we feel the effects of that unchecked oppression for so long that we feel the need to express outrage and to remind people with the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. This is not accusatory. This is first and foremost meant to be an interrogation of myself. What type of pain, prophetic pain, did we feel to elicit a prophetic response when we see these things? It takes the issue of one person, like in the case of Hilf al-Fudul, to capture the sentiment of what was systematically taking place in the background for so long. It took one person to cry and to express pain and to call out the Meccans on their hypocrisy. With a system that was running in the background for very long, to mobilize people. And sometimes it takes the story of that person to mobilize us. And I pray that that is the case with our brother, George Floyd, that moves us all to once and for all, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, rectify this great evil that has been taking place for so long. And I want to rectify a few concepts, inshallah ta'ala, and then I'll pass it on to those who I'm here to listen to tonight. Some people have reduced this to an issue of race and have made it a point to say, well, not all white people are racist. And I want to remind everyone that this is an issue of state violence. So yes, the claim is not that all white people are racist. The claim is that state violence operates in racism. The claim is not that every police officer is racist. The claim is that policing is racist in America, inherently racist in America. And the reason why that's so important is Sheikh Dawood mentioned a Musawi voice. And you have a Musawi voice, but you have to recognize it's a Fir'aunic system to have a Musawi voice when you're speaking about this. State violence is born out of white supremacy. State violence in this country is born out of a system of white supremacy. Guess what else? Poverty in America is racialized and born out of a system of white supremacy. Our domestic policies and our foreign policies are nurtured by and in white supremacy. So if it's a cop, here we had Officer Wiley in Dallas, Texas. If it's a black officer wearing a blue uniform that murders or that shoots a man here who was trying to get into his truck, and the officer assumed that he was stealing a truck and quickly fired bullets. He woke up in a hospital bed with chains on his arms and on his feet. And people said, well, he was a black officer, but it wasn't about the skin color of the officer. It was about the color of his uniform and the state violence that is nurtured by white supremacy in this situation. So when someone says, well, is this about apathy? If this is about apathy, what about this violence and what about that violence? And I want to make it a point to nip this in the bud. To use black on black violence is a cop out. It is not acceptable. First of all, most people, in fact, all groups are killed primarily by those that are in direct proximity of them. We don't say white on white violence. We don't say Muslim on Muslim violence. And so this only serves to reinforce some sort of association of violence with black identity, which allows us to escape from the issue of state violence. And guess what? State violence and poverty and racialized poverty and the conditions that have been created that lead us to these tragedies over and over and over again are nurtured by the same system of white supremacy. Imagine if, when raising an objection to an Obama drone in Yemen or a Trump drone in Afghanistan, someone says, well, most of the time it's Muslims that are killing each other in Afghanistan and Muslims that are killing each other in Yemen. We shouldn't even be worried about that. But the same system that enabled the drone to fall enabled the chaos that led to the overall collapse of those societies and perpetuated those conditions that lead to continued systemic oppression. In America, the entire system between racialized poverty, police agencies, the criminal justice system, and all of the implications of that are all nurtured by a Fir'aunic system that has to be challenged openly. So let me just say some specific things that we are pushing for, because I think it's a problem when we only speak in abstracts, and this becomes a can't we all just get along call in response to all of this. And the state, which does not want to be on trial, shifts tactfully the discussion to a secondary issue to its transgression, which led to the original grievance. And that's the problem in Muslims. We can't fall for that. That doesn't mean you can't speak about methods. That doesn't mean that you can't speak about how to challenge. That means that the focus of the conversation cannot become other than the initial grievance, a grievance and a transgression that has been left unchecked for so long. And so I want to put forth some specific calls that you make and that you work with the organizations that have been doing this work on police brutality for a long time. The Brady List. Most Muslims have never heard of the Brady List. Most people have never heard of the Brady List. Why is it that we have no transparency of who the cops on these police forces are? Why is it that we don't know their previous records? If someone goes out, if someone steals gum from a gas station in high school and has that on their record, then that could doom them for the rest of their lives. If someone gets put in a horrible situation as a young person, that could doom them for the rest of their lives. But you have a cop that had 17 previous violations of excessive force. Where is the transparency of who those cops are? I want to know the history of how many times that officer has used the weapon and why is he not fired? I want to know if that officer is a war veteran from Iraq that has a previous issue. I want to know why my police department is being trained by the IDF in learning occupational military tactics. Transparency has to precede accountability. I asked the police chief in Dallas here, why is it that we don't know, or what can we do to know? Make a very clear demand. Officers that have those repeated, like that man that killed Dr. Jamila Arshad in New Orleans, we should know who these officers are, and they should be fired. They should be disciplined. They should not be lurking the streets, and we should have some sort of transparency. And the response I got from the police chief was, we don't have the technology. We have the technology to make drones. We have the technology to come up with all this sophisticated technology to harm people further, but we don't have the technology, was the answer that I got. Pushing forth with the Brady list, pushing forth very specific calls that the police should not be the first responders to mental health calls unless a firearm is involved. Why is it that when someone has a mental health issues and police brutality victims are disproportionately suffering from mental health issues, why is it that the police are dispatched first and they can quickly shoot a gun and say someone lunged at me? How does that work with zip codes? Do the police respond to a drug call if it's rich people's drugs? You know, if there is someone that's passed out or that's someone that's acting erratically, acting out in a rich suburban area, do the police react in the same way? Why are there concentrations of police in certain areas? Why do police respond disproportionately to certain spots and different zip codes? Why not demand city officials demand increased investment in alternatives to police responses rather than continuing to feed the system in the way that we feed the system? And so the point is, and I'm not going to go through the entire list, the importance of specific calls, and keeping the issue in focus of that grievance and that transgression that has led people that are fed up and that are not okay with the status quo to demand a meaningful change in society. And that's why mana is so important. And I say this with a full heart, that the Quran and the Sunnah, we can only support an issue or a method, religiously, politically, and socially, that abides by the Quran and the Sunnah. The fear of people departing from the Quran and the Sunnah, from what is prophetic, an issue or method, is real. The fear of people adopting illegitimate political platforms, running uncritically to the embrace of those that only perpetuate and devise mechanisms that perpetuate these horrific things without doing anything, that's a real problem. But at the same time, we have to do our part, inshallah ta'ala, to offer that Quran and that Sunnah paradigm bi'idhnillah ta'ala. جزاكم الله خيرا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I'm trying to turn on my timer. Give myself my 12 minutes. Inshallah ta'ala. Barakallahu feekum. So, alhamdulillah, we thank everyone for helping to make this possible. All of the brothers and sisters working behind the scene at MANA. We'd like to thank Brother Tariq, our Zoom Meister, for this event. We'd like to thank the other Tariq Masidi for allowing us to use the Celebrate Mercy platform, the wonderful work that they do. We had actually used a Zoom meeting platform, and that doesn't augur well, especially in this climate. And so they allowed us to use their webinar platform, and alhamdulillah, we've had 1,012 on the actual Celebrate Mercy platform, and then Facebook Live, I don't know how many, but it's not about the numbers. Islam is not about numbers, it's about quality. And anyway, a lot of people out there are saying, what's the big deal? And as was mentioned earlier, some Muslims, what's the big deal about George Floyd? And specifically, and what's the big deal about African-American, this exceptional attention to the plight of African-Americans, all of these people talking about white supremacy. And before I go further, anything I say is in addition to what anyone else has previously stated and not an attempt to negate anything at all that they might have said. These issues are nuanced and complex. And so there are many different angles we can look at them from. And all of those angles should be viewed as mutually reinforcing and none of them as mutually exclusive. But to go back to this initial query, George Floyd did not create this focus on African Americans in this country. George Floyd did not create, or his killing rather, did not, his sadistic pornographic murder did not create this focus. America itself created this focus. If we go back to the beginning of the Republic, only one people were identified as three-fifths of a human being, for of a man, for representational purposes. That was the African people, no other people. George Floyd wasn't around then. There was only one civil war fought in this country. A lot of people like to see one now, but only one was fought. And it was fought over the issue of the enslavement of one people only, African people. In 1896, Plessy versus Ferguson specifically institutionalized, legalized the segregation of one people, specifically the legalized discrimination, I should say, against one people only, African American people. And before that, Reconstruction was followed by a campaign of terror to disenfranchise the political progress of one people alone, the African American people. The Civil War, as we move further into history, 1954, Brown versus the Board of Education was an attempt to undo injustices recognized by the Supreme Court against one people, specifically African American people. The 1994 Omnibus Crime Bill was used to institute a regime of mass incarceration that targeted especially, not exclusively, but especially one people, the African American people. I think you get the idea. So this exceptionalism was created by the country itself, not by George Floyd. We should understand this. But we have to balance. We have to balance between our love and passion for our people. We have to balance between our ability to look our young generation in the eye. My niece was an organizer for one of the protests in the state of Connecticut. She was an organizer. I can't look her in the eye and say, you should stay home. You know, just chill out. No, I could tell her, be peaceful. I could tell her to be careful. I could tell her to speak the truth. Don't go up public and speak falsely. I can't tell her to stay home. I can't tell my nephew, who's not a thug, who has a master's degree, and I think he started his PhD. He works with struggling young men in Hartford, Connecticut. I can't tell him, stay home. They'll think you're a thug. He knows who he is, and he knows what's moving him, and he knows the pain that most of us should feel. If you can watch, and maybe we shouldn't even be watching, that murder and not be pained, something's wrong. Something's wrong, brothers and sisters, but we have to balance between that pain and planning, as our sister Ieasha mentioned so powerfully. We have to plan, we have to build, we have to organize, we have to develop a foundation to begin to systematically address institutionalized and systematic realities. Some people will say, oh, police violence in this country is not institutionalized. If it's not institutional, some people will deny it's even real. How come every year, last year, 1,100 people were killed by the police? Europe, all of Europe, including Great Britain, not the European Union as currently constituted, all of Europe, including Great Britain, add in Canada, add in New Zealand, add in Australia, combined with a population of over 800 million, almost three times the size of the United States, they had 120 police killings combined. Why does the United States have 10 times that number? That is an institutionalized reality that's built on certain concrete foundations. And we have to begin to question those foundations. We have to begin to chisel away at those foundations until they are no more. That is our call, brothers and sisters. That is our call. New Zealand, we mentioned New Zealand. from 1916 until today, there have been 40 police killings in New Zealand. 40 police killings. That's an average of one every 2.5 years. One every 2.5 years. Every 2.5 years in this country, there are over 2,500 on average. We have to work to change that, because that is a specific, unique American phenomenon. We have to work to change it. We have our work to do. We have our responsibility to our people, as Imam Daoud mentioned. We love our people. Our people are us. We can't hate our people and not hate ourselves. But we also have a responsibility to our fellow citizens. And I'm going to say this, I'm going to qualify it, because I don't want anyone tweeting out that I said this, that, or the other. The if you're an African American in this country, unarmed, you can work the statistics any way you want. You can create all the caveats you want. But the raw statistics, if you're unarmed and African American, you're 4 to 5 times more likely to die the way that George Floyd died, at the hands of law enforcement. You might not be shot. He wasn't shot. That's the reality. You're twice as likely as other demographic groups in this country. That's a fact. 12% of the population, 25% of the police killings. Twice as likely. That's a fact. But it's also a fact that twice as many white people, or European Americans, should I say, are killed every year by law enforcement. Do I say that to reduce the atrocity of what happened to George Floyd, or what happened to Tamir Rice, who was mentioned, or what happened to Alden Sterling, or what happened to Oscar Grant, or what happened to Trayvon Martin, a police vigilante, not a formal police person, or what happened to Sean Bell, or what happened to Amadou Diallo, or what happened to Rekia Boyd, or what happened to Ayanna Jones, or what happened to Sandra Bland, or what happened to all of these black men, women, and children? No, not at all. But to say that this problem affects other people. And it's important for us to recognize that. During the week that Alden Sterling and Philando Castile were killed, during that week, 5 Latinos were killed between Arizona, Nevada, and California in the same week. So this problem, what I'm saying, it goes beyond any one community, although our community suffers disproportionately. I said that as passionately as I can on this webinar without scaring people. But all of us will have to come together to bring it to an end. There's no one community who can do it by themselves. We cannot do it alone. We need help. We need help to bring it to an end. And if we don't feel the pain of that European American or that Latino mother or father or brother or sister, if we don't feel that pain, and that pain and feeling that pain removes us rather to benevolently reach out to those communities and build bridges of collective action, then there are people like White Lives Matter, a neo-Nazi group, like the Boogaloo Boys, who will reach out with malicious intent to exploit that pain, to pull us further and further apart and push us further and further away from a solution to this problem. I'll conclude with this. As I said, everything that Omar Suleiman or anyone else, Dr. Omar Suleiman or anyone else said about white supremacy, it's true. But we have to understand one thing. We have to understand, brothers and sisters, that white supremacy has its origin in 1675, Bacon's Rebellion. And what happened during Bacon's Rebellion? rebellion. During Bacon's rebellion, a complex set of issues. Bacon was, he was a rich man, but his poor slaves, both the European slaves and the African slaves, were brought together by Mr. Bacon to foment a rebellion that nearly unseated those who were sitting at the helm of power. And they devised the what would become white supremacy, not immediately to dehumanize the Africans. That was an intended consequence that played out in time. But the immediate intent was to break the unity of those rebellious white and black, and whether European American or white American and African, who would become Americans a couple centuries later, slaves. So there will be no unified resistance against a corrupt and oppressive system. And so in these days, when we have to have unified resistance, there are elements in our society that would like nothing better than to use whatever they can to pull us apart. We have to have the vision. We have to have the passion. We have to have the dedication, yes, to love our people and to call out the injustices perpetrated against our people, but also to love this country that is our home and to come together to preserve it, because there are people who are hell-bent on tearing it apart. And I'm not referring to those who might be classified as the oppressed. There are a lot of people in the category of the oppressors who would tear it apart if they could. So may we have tawfiq, may we balance between that passionate commitment and love for our people and our responsibility to our fellow citizens, whoever they are. We have to balance between our spiritual yearning and the metaphysical teachings of our religion. But if we go too far in that direction, then we will abandon aspects of our religion that are clear in the Quran and Sunnah that calls for us to be a source of relief for those who are oppressed and downtrodden in our society. And to end, I'll end on this. We'll bring the metaphysical together with the actual societal realities. إِنَّمَا تُرْزَقُونَ وَتُنْصَرُونَ بِدُعَفَائِكُمْ. That rather you are given divine aid. This is the metaphysical. Aid coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not from our human means and capacities, based on how you treat the downtrodden and the oppressed amongst you. And so, and that's society, that's reality, that's on the ground. So we have to bring these two together and avoid any imbalances. May Allah give us tawfiq, may Allah ta'ala bless all of these wonderful, wonderful panelists. May Allah bless this patient audience whose numbers have been consistent throughout. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Ya Allah, we thank you so much for this opportunity for us to come together and just to know you. Thank you for guiding us to this deen. We ask, Ya Rabbi, that you give us a light from you by which we're able to provide a light in times of darkness. Ya Rabbi, we ask that you give us assistance from you, Ya Rabbi, by which we're able to pull ourselves up and be a means of assistance to others. Ya Rabbi, Ya Al-Muhaymin, we ask that you please build the fortress of your protection around us. Ya Rabbi, we ask that you reach deep into the hearts of those who oppress. Ya Rabbi, in turn their hearts. Ya Rabbi, guide their minds. Ya Rabbi, and those whom you decide shall not be guided, we ask that you push them far away from us as the north is from the west. Ya Rabbi, I ask that you please envelop us in your care, cradle us in your comfort. Ya Rabbi, we ask that you grant us a healing from you, grant us a strength from your strength and honor from your honor. Allah, we ask that you make us amongst those who are truly people of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and who follow his message according to the methodology by which you instructed. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala mursaleen wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ameen.